Susan. In this session, I'd just like to talk about some work that Rosie Jeremaloo and I are doing in conjunction with a range of rabbit managers who are dealing with peri-urban rabbits across Australia. And at the conclusion, invite anyone who's facing the problems of peri-urban rabbits to please get in touch and share your knowledge with us as well. I'll just give a quick intro to what peri-urban rabbits are, give you a taste of what's in the framework, and then conclude with that invitation. So where are peri-urban rabbits? All across Australia. Anywhere we find generally smaller holdings, but typically lots of neighbours and rabbits that may be free-ranging from one property to another. Often very mixed communities, so very diverse in their understanding, but also in their attitudes to a whole range of things that might affect rabbit control. And limited in some ways, the control options that are available, maybe through regulations such as prohibiting the use of 1080. It can be just the physical environment, the amount of infrastructure and the nature of that that's around that makes it very difficult to use some of the broadacre control mechanisms. And finally, just all the social diversity that I spoke about can bring a whole lot of constraints in as well. So it's an Australian-wide problem. In peri-urban areas, it's seen from, could be anything from the rabbits reducing someone's veggie patch to nothing, through to undermining major commercial or industrial infrastructure, as well as the potential for breeding to be occurring and for us to start to see immunities develop there, which could then be spread out to other areas. I can just shift that so I can actually see what I'm supposed to be saying. We've asked a group of people that we became aware of that were dealing with peri-urban rabbits across Australia to come together and share their knowledge and their experience. So it's a big cross-section we've got from all sorts of areas involved with rabbit management, with a few experts such as Brian and Amy, that you'll hear from shortly. Have come in as well to give a hand. It's very informal. We keep in touch with emails. We occasionally have an online meeting. We've been very keen to hear what people are doing, whether just interviews or some mini case studies. And we've encouraged people to ask questions. And when we have a question come through that we don't know the answer to, we consult some experts and we put together an information sheet, thinking if someone's asked that question, others may well have the same queries. It's been really beneficial for us as an organisation. It's given us a much better understanding of the issues and the constraints. We've unearthed lots of really innovative examples of what people are trying in this space. And I don't think we've seen too many complete examples, but when you take that knowledge and experience of all those people that have been involved, we've come up with a very comprehensive and very broad body of knowledge. And it's been enough to give us some confidence that we can see some patterns in what people have done that we think we could pull together as a framework that might be of real value to people who are moving into this space for the first time. The approach we're using is very much the same as we'd have in other areas, but with a few variations. Firstly, is one about understanding, and it's really making sure the community understand that rabbits are causing a problem and that problem can be solved. The second part is about engaging the community. It's really about making sure people are on side, or at least not opposed to seeing rabbit control. So it requires some effort in that regard. The final bit we've done is a little bit more emphasis than we'd normally have on the outcomes, just making sure that what you've been trying to achieve, you've been able to achieve. In this talk, I'll In each of the sections there, so the diagram is just a representation of that previous diagram in a different format. Each section will go through key questions and a checklist and a heap of examples, as well as more context and background information. In this talk, we'll one section assess, looking at some questions and some examples. And planning will just look at the engaging community side, and then I'll finish off just looking at some bits on management. So in this one, it's a typical structure where we have some leading questions to just get people thinking through. One of the first one is just making sure that people do appreciate there is harm being caused by rabbits. Next one's making sure that people have sufficient information to plan a rabbit control program. And question four there relates to just making people aware of the range of options that are available. So it's really brainstorming about making sure you understand the full list of options, what they require, what are the pros and cons of each. So no real sorting at that stage, but just being aware that all these options are available. Some examples from that. This is a great little example from Phillip Island in Victoria. Very simple rabbit exposure. The little purpley flowers here are a little native. It's one of the species that's like chocolates to rabbits, they just love them. And so there's none outside that exposure, flowering beautifully inside. Seeing's believing, really simple, makes people start to appreciate what harm rabbits can be doing. The other thing that's often been used, things like a walk and talk, again, showing people the harm that's occurring, but probably even more importantly, hearing from affected landholders, hearing the stress in their voices, hearing the emotional problems that come with rabbits as well. And it's all part of getting the community starting to see the problem through the same set of eyes. And the final bit I want to mention in this section is examples of how people go about sharing that information, that solutions are available. It might be a workshop, it might be field days, but there's something just so that there's, once again, the community end up with some common understandings. Here's a problem, here's some solutions. In the planning side, it's begs that question, so what will you need to do in your community to get people onto the same page? And we've seen some really innovative little solutions to that. They range from a bunny bake-off, an area that got a number of the chefs together and gave them the challenge of cooking up a rabbit meal. Now that's not going to do too much to reduce rabbit numbers, but really gives an opportunity to have a conversation about rabbits and rabbit management. We see some use too of compliance letters, a reminder to landholders from a regulatory body about their responsibilities to control rabbits on their property. Lots of use of incentives, equipment hire, those sorts of things. And as you're moving through there, it's starting to look too for commitment to take some action. So one of the groups we work with, they have a requirement that if communities are going to be involved, they have to do some basic training first and do an online training course. Others, where they're involved in doing some of the field work, have a requirement that the community undertake to do all the monitoring work that's associated with it. So just ways to move from understanding and sharing support to really getting commitment from people to be involved. The final section is looking at those control options, and if you look at that list, it's probably pretty similar to what you'd see anywhere. The real difference is in the nature of how those different techniques are applied and the weighting between them. I mentioned before about baiting. 1080 is not an option quite often through regulations, So there's reliance on Pindone and probably even more reliance on K5. While there's some work on Warrens, often that's very difficult in peri-urban areas, and instead of getting some heavy equipment in, it might be a person on the end of a shovel caving in burrows by hand. So we don't see as much of that as we'd like to see. The emphasis is probably more on cleaning up debris and other forms of rapid harbour. A number of the other techniques are ones that are usually associated with mopping up, but they're often the only tools that are really available. And the other thing that we see a lot more of in peri-urban areas is just accepting that they're there and protecting assets, whether that be property or infrastructure, just ensuring that rabbits can't get in and undermine buildings. So where are we at in this stage? We're getting fairly comfortable now that we've got the right questions and the right checklists to go there. And they're available on an app if you'd like to see that from the conference app. What we're really keen to do is develop more and more of those stories. And we'd love to hear from more people about what they're doing, how they're grappling with these same issues. One of the things that's come from talking with these people is that there's no standard solution to this. Every community is different, every environment's different, and people who've got their heads around this are really good at tailoring it to their needs. So, as I finish, acknowledge the members of the forum who have contributed so much to this. Please get in touch with us and share your stories and help us make peri-urban areas of Australia rabbit-free. Thank you.
Question from Clayton. Monitoring the success of programs is often considered a low priority when compared to actual control works. Do you have any tips for implementing monitoring that is cost effective while providing strong data?
That technical level, I'd have to say no, not at the technical level, but because of that difficulty in getting the monitoring, it's certainly been used. So some of the groups we have in that early part of finding out where are the rabbits, how many, etc., then made that a community exercise and had people out from the community on spotlighting counts and got them to take on that role. And they freely share that information on little social media apps that they've had to keep in touch. There's been examples from one area. So it's that sort of thing involving people in it, through to that side of another group saying, we won't do any work here until we've got people lined up to do the monitoring, and this is how it's going to be rolling out. So it's making sure the community is really on side and committed to the program, and you've got a good program to start with before you roll it out.
And in 1 minute, I've got a controversial question. Do you see a role for the foundation in advocating for the retention of and best practice use of Pindone in peri-urban areas?
Foundations have the core role, we have three roles. The primary reason for the foundation coming into existence was to encourage research into better control for rabbits and particularly biocontrols. We find to do that, we have to run things like a national conversation. It's no use without encouraging people to understand about rabbits. And so, yeah, we're publishing kids' books. It's got nothing to do with research. And the final one is about encouraging the adoption of best practice. We tend to be a nerdy mob. We've got our board has lots of PhDs on it. And if anything, we see ourselves filling gaps at times. We're not really out to conquer the world, but if we see a gap that's holding things back, we'll try to move into that. And so the area about Pindone is certainly one now. We're working with some technicians in that area to try and develop a thing. Here's the science behind best practice. That's the role we have. We're not really an advocate for one thing over another. It's really about making sure that people have good science in front of them and can then make their decisions about the best management practices that they'll adopt.